Welcome back to Higher Density Living. This is the late night hour.
Actually, it's not late night hour.
It's 9 o'clock in the morning.
Yes.
I am trying to wake up.
Yeah, you climbed all weekend.
I did. I climbed
in the sun
from 11 a.m. Till 5:30 p.m.
Wow.
Straight.
That's a lot of climbing.
I was a mess. I don't even. It's amazing your forearms can just keep holding on. Keep on holding on.
We were talking about bears,
yeah,
right before.
Bears chasing people. I have found out recently, bears are growing in intelligence.
Oh, wow.
If you go out hiking, you know they have the bear cans? It's got like special lid covers
and stuff.
Oh,
yeah.
Well, I'm sure that's probably quite frustrating for a bear to try and get in there, right? So they've gotten really smart over at Yosemite. You want to know what they're doing?
This is great.
They said, fuck it. Let's take the whole can up the mountain and throw it off the side.
Oh, no way.
Dude, they drag the whole thing up and throw it from hundreds of feet up, and they have it blow up on the ground, and then they go pick the trash up.
That's awesome. They're like, I need that McDonald's McChicken wrapper. I love licking that thing.
I was talking about ravens or crows in Japan, because they'll pick nuts up and drop them in intersections.
And wait for cars to run them over.
And then someone's like, oh, have you seen the bears in Yosemite recently? I'm like, what are you talking about? Like, yeah, they've been dragging all the bear cans up because they can't get in them, and they just drop and have them blow open.
I think it's...
Well,
it's nature always finds a way. So...
Always.
Yeah. I mean, it's no matter what. It's like you were showing me the cactus when you were climbing.
Isn't that amazing?
And then how it has to root into the rock and probably weasel its way all around.
This is a variant of granite in this rock down in Socorro, New Mexico, where they have the SETI satellites and stuff like that. And so you're like 65 feet up, and there's a cactus just growing out of the rock. like nobody's business.
That will to survive.
Is amazing.
Yeah.
And in the most like ridiculous places, life springs up.
But you have to think, what's easier, taking a can up a mountain and throwing it down to eat trash, or chasing after an elk? You know, so they're just looking at it.
Well, path of least resistance for them.
For them, yeah.
This is a guaranteed win.
Yeah,
I can smell it in there. I can't get it out, so I'm gonna drop it. Have it, and then I'm gonna use it against itself.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly.
How do you stop the unstoppable force? Use another unstoppable force.
But there's this, disconnect with nature that we have as humans, and we're going to get into probably a series on it. But when we look at philosophy and we look at whether it's, who is the guy that wrote all the books and he lived out in a little, you know who I'm talking about. I can't believe I lost his name. He wrote Frost and
Robert Frost.
Yeah, Robert Frost. Yeah, and he wrote about nature and being
Ralph
in nature.
Ralph Waldo Emerson.
All of those guys. Yeah, and that time period where it was like, go back to nature, see what it's doing and discovering, and a lot of biologists have that viewpoint by looking at and understanding nature better, then we can, it will help solve. Which I believe that I think every problem humanity has can be solved through nature. It's just our observation of the nature.
Definitely.
It's like, obviously the rainforests, which were taking down at, huge amount of clips, but they said that pretty much has all the medical benefits. It's a medical treasure chest.
I love it.
To heal everything that mankind has.
I think Valium comes from a certain type of flower.
Oh, yeah.
I think that's where they synthesized it from.
Yeah. You can chew on cocaine, right?
Coca leaves, yeah. I would love to. Yeah. It's not been synthesized yet, so I'll just get the regular plant, get a little jacked up, a little stimulant, I want to say that when I was out, it was about 4.5 hours in, and I'd been outside for a bit. I've been doing a lot of climbing, and I'm down, and I'm getting ready to belay someone to go up. That means you're standing on the bottom. You're essentially feeding them rope,
right?
And then you catch them if they fall. Try to catch them. And for a moment, I wouldn't call it zoning out. I think this was one of these brief times in my life where I actually was legitimately in the moment without any forced thinking to
be
in the moment.
You were in flow state.
It was amazing. I have beautiful red granite in front of me. I have a juniper bush, which I can smell in the hot sun behind me, putting shade across my shoulders. I have the sun beating down on my head. I have birds chirping and moving through all the brush and the cacti, and I can hear the wind sweeping through the timpani, which is like the carved out part of the rocks. And it's just like making this noise that is just absolutely surreal. And I was just lost there for a second. It didn't matter what time it was. It didn't, nothing at that moment mattered. I was completely consumed in nature. I haven't felt like I've been in a moment like that for a very long time. And this is, you know, I'm working out, I'm doing everything, you know, like, but it was just, that was it. No thought, nothing. It was just a complete feeling within that moment. Sensed and listened to everything without a thought. It was amazing. Absolutely amazing. And then when I woke up the next morning, my whoop went to like 86% recovered. And I had like a 18 something day strain, which was huge on my heart.
Right, right.
And, but the day prior, I was only at like 56% recovery. So being outside with increased activity, but being in nature for that long, recharged my body. I was in the sun from 11 to 5:30, climbing in Socorro, New Mexico. Dry, hot, beating down on you. I just thought, I don't know. I don't know what to tell you, but the data shows that when I'm outside, it actually recovers my body. When I'm like with stone, like touching it, being in nature that close to it, it actually like heals me internally.
What your shirt color is that today?
Lululemon, shout out. Yeah.
So I want to get into, speaking of philosophy, I want to get into, because this has become real popular in the last few years, Ayn Rand. And I know a lot of people have read Atlas Shrugged or maybe The Fountainhead, and those are, you know, novels. She was born in 1905 and then died in 1982. She was born in St. Petersburg, Russia. And she witnessed what shaped her philosophy was she witnessed, and hopefully I pronounce this right, the Bolshevik Revolution?
Bolshevik Revolution.
And so, you know, any type of socialism, fascism, you know, she was extremely, and she saw things that were happening here in the United States when she came here. You know, and she started off, she had no money, no nothing, you know, homeless. And so she started off working in Hollywood because that's where she wound up at, in, you know, being a seamstress and helping out with props and stuff like that. And then she worked her way up, you know, because she had the gift of writing. So she worked her way up. And then these are best-selling
books. Stitching words together.
Yeah, stitching words together. Yeah, exactly. So,
useless, sorry.
So she created a philosophy, and I wanted to bounce it back and forth. I thought this would be interesting. And, you know, maybe we'll have eventually have a philosophy series and we can go through over time. We'll go through all the philosophers. But I like to bounce them against creational law.
Sure.
Yeah. So I think it would be interesting to
see how much clout it has.
Yeah. See how much clout it has. And then kind of, and then, you know, evolutionary processes. But this is what she says. So let's talk about objectivism. Do you have the definition of it?
No.
I have it right here.
Yeah. Please.
This
tell
is
me.
From Atlas Shrugged. My philosophy is the concept of man as a heroic being.
Okay.
With his own happiness as the moral purpose of his life.
Okay.
With productive achievement as its noblest activity and reason as his only absolute. So before we get into the reason part, because everybody wants to jump there, the concept of man as a heroic being, this is a totally opposite of what you get with religion. This statement.
Well, when you think,
because we're sinners, as not good, need God.
Correct. And when you talk about heroic, you're a champion.
Right.
So you're going through the hero's journey.
Right.
And when she says you're a heroic being, there's learning that has to happen. You have to associate yourself with certain tools and resources, with certain groups to help you through this journey that you are going through. So that in the end, you could elevate yourself. Not to be better than the rest of society, but to just be like, I am the best I can be within society itself. That's that.
But
that's
the best that you can be is service to others by you being.
Don't jump the gun.
But you know what I'm saying.
I know you're going to jump the gun, though.
Yeah, yeah, I'm not going to. So is the concept of man as a heroic being?
Yes, done.
This H word I want to talk about, with his own happiness as the moral purpose of his life. And I know this is hedonistic, the word happiness, and I would love to be able to talk to her on this, and maybe as I study her more, I can find out. But with his own happiness as a moral purpose of his life, that H word is kind of the main purpose of the moral purpose of his life is his happiness.
Yeah, you know, happiness is interesting, because happiness is like a temporary thing, like it's up and down.
Right.
So, like, happiness is like the main focus, main goal. Is that strictly in the material sense? Was she saying something like that?
With his own happiness as a moral purpose of his life, with productive achievement as his noblest activity.
Okay, so moral.
Right.
So when you talk about your morals, what are you going to do that's best for you to create that happiness?
Because she didn't believe in God or any of that. So
No, she was extremely secular.
Right.
And she looked at a lot of things. She looked at things as systems.
Right.
Which is cool. That's fine. But if we talk about essentially a moral achievement, that when you reach happiness, that means you're doing the right moral things for yourself and others.
True happiness.
True.
True happiness, I'm down with her statement.
Yeah.
But if I'm just reading this generically, and I'm 21 years old, and I'm really excited about Atlas Shrugged because I want to work for Goldman Sachs and you know, be the best analyst I can be.
Had and not get fired every quarter at bottom 10%.
And work 20 hours a day and 7 days a week, you know. But
like slave ship.
Yeah, exactly. So this feeds into that. It's just like, well, you know, I'm screwing these people over, but I'm happy. That's my moral purpose of life. But that's not true happiness.
We've lost the depth of that statement altogether.
Right.
That's a very shallow way of looking at this. And I think she gets hammered on this stuff a lot. There's a lot of people are like, oh, you're reading Ayn Rand?
Yeah, exactly.
You know, like Atlas Shrugged?
She has a lot
of... It's all about you.
Well, she's going against... I mean, she's radical. She's going against... I mean, if you really think about it, most countries are based off of religion. The ideologies.
Every single country is based
off religion. So she's going against that.
Every single country is based off religion. I can't look at this map right now, not one of them, and say it's not based off of religion. Every single one. Every single one.
I know. I'm like...
Of course people are not going to like this.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
And then capitalism gets in bed with religion, and she is against that.
Yeah.
Bad forms of it. People are going to be like, no, screw this lady. So, yeah. But then she talks about past the moral achievement.
Purpose, right? With productive achievement as his noblest activity.
Yeah, productive achievement.
That's evolution to me.
Yeah, well, of course it is. She's talking about moving up in the tiers. It's your journey, hero's journey. Someone hands you a tool. Maybe you form a new tool that helps you with that productive achievement. What is productive? You know, when you read that, you can look at it strictly in the material sense. Oh, I've created so much stuff. Oh, I've earned so much wealth.
Mm-hmm.
That's only looking at it half-baked. You got to look at the full thing. You got to keep that thing in the oven for a bit and really think about it. You got to ruminate on it.
Mm-hmm.
You got to wait for all the smells to come out before that cake's ready. But what we're talking about here is productive achievement. That I can be productive in achievement of how I want to treat people. Maybe that's my benchmark in my thing to be a hero.
Well, we talked about this the other day, and I think this is when we talked about Breedlove stuff, Robert Breedlove, and he talked about value. And the more I study this, Antifragile book talks about this. That exchange of value,
yeah.
To me, so when I see productive achievement, and I'm giving a ton of value,
yeah,
that's productive achievement.
Of course. What if you learn something? Is that productive achievement?
Yes, of course.
What if it's a mental thing that was learned? Is that productive achievement? Of course it is. This whole thing has been taken with such a materialistic view, it almost eroded a lot of the value of what she was writing about. I don't know her personally,
right?
But if I look at this in the balance. If you take it in the lens of, and I'm going to use the word lens, of these creational laws, because these are very objective things, and we're going to talk about objectivism. These are very objective things that we can see. It's in front of us. The data's there. We can watch and observe it. It is a truthful thing occurring. This starts to align with a lot of things that are going on here. But if I look at it just in a materialistic view, things start to drop off precipitously. The value of this drops off completely, and a lot of it is missed for what it can actually be applied with that could be beneficial for the individual in their journey.
Well, I mean, the bears in Yosemite are a perfect example. The moral purpose of his life is happiness.
Yeah.
And then the productive achievement as his noblest activity. Okay, humans, you keep designing these trash cans.
Here's my productive achievement.
I'm going to create value for me and my cubs.
By bringing it up here and dropping it off.
It's productive achievement. Yeah. I figured out it's a puzzle and I figured it out.
But it had to learn something mentally before it took the physical action.
And then the last statement is production is noblest activity. And we'll get into this a little bit. And reason as his only absolute.
That is true. Because when you talk about reason, I love this. When you talk about reason, you're speaking about logic. You're talking about rationale. You're looking at something in such a lens like that is here. This is legitimate. It is not hypothetical. Mm-hmm. And I can understand that the cause and effect from here to here is either beneficial or detrimental to me. So the ability to reason is a phenomenal track. It's a tool that you have in your journey to use cause and effect to your advantage. And then after you have mastered the understanding of it, then you can go out as your best self and then help elevate others in their own production, whether it's a production of thought or it's a production of goods and services that are beneficial to the collective. It's akin to this. If I'm a surgeon standing outside of a hospital taking a smoke break, is that best for the surgeon? Smoking?
No.
No, it's not. Even all the objective data tells you this is not good for you, but he does it anyway. Should then that individual go out in that hospital and say, I'm going to manage all these surgeries? You're making a fundamentally poor decision about your own health, but you're saying you want to go here and help save others? In an objective sense, that's completely, it's totally illogical.
Right.
The reasoning would say, stay away from that guy. Remove him from his position because of that thought. But the fact, because he has a title and he's in the hospital, he's done all these surgeries, you choose to support him? That doesn't work. And that's the type of thing she wants to fight against.
Yeah. And she's going to tie reality with happiness.
I'm having a blast.
Yeah, yeah, I know. Listen to this. One cannot achieve happiness by wish or whim. It requires rational respect for the facts of reality.
Oh my gosh. Was she listening to our podcast? My goodness, she's right on the creational laws.
And then she says, including the facts about our human nature and needs.
Yeah, we know what we need. We want to achieve that, even if you look at Maslow.
So before you get into Maslow, let's get into, it requires rational respect for the facts of reality.
If you are, if you do not respect the truth, yes. You live in a lie.
If you do not respect reality.
Yeah.
Because how many of us think about this. This table is here. It's hard. It's here. It's made up of atoms. I mean, science has proven.
It's right here.
I cannot, as much as, but see, here's the problem that we have.
Tell me.
In society.
Tell me the problem.
The problem that we have in society is we're telling people, especially now, and we talked about postmodernism, that really, is this a table? How does the table feel for you?
Oh my God.
You know, is a table, if you want to call it not a table and you want to call it something else, that's fine. No, it's a fucking table.
It's a table. look up at the sun, do we want to call it something? No, it's the sun. It's a star. That's just what it is. Do I just say, do atoms work for you? Should we call it something else? Are they going to change their laws for you? No, they're not. These are definites.
Yes.
These stay.
Yeah.
You want to know why? Because they're timeless. They're truthful. And if you had some rationale or some reason or some logic, you would see that.
Because when I put this coffee table here and when I put this coffee on the table, I'm doing it and I don't need belief.
No, you know.
You see where I'm going here?
Creational laws, laws of nature, hold this thing in place.
Right.
Otherwise, it would fall through the table.
I don't even have to think about it. I just put,
You wouldn't be able to hear our voices, wavelengths, which is everything would fall apart. If there was no reason, rationale, and logic to creation, you couldn't have structure. You couldn't have form. You couldn't have geometry.
But don't you think it's funny how many people want to, and she talks about this a lot. And this is where, you know, like even on simulation theory, multiverses, all that stuff, you know, you can get too heavy into that in a sense where you're bypassing reality.
Supersymmetry.
Yeah, you're bypassing reality. And this is what she's saying. She goes, she says this later. She goes, you cannot take 100% responsibility for yourself until you begin to understand reality.
That is awesome.
Because that's what we want to do, though.
We talk about that. That's that self-awareness. Yeah. If you cannot look at the world and say, this is what it is, and work within the frame of what is,
right,
instead of what isn't, most people live in the what isn't, the hypothetical.
Yes.
Listen, because of the law of free will, you have the ability to do that. But it's also considered the law of confusion because you have the choice to deviate away from creation, deviate away from natural laws, physics, rationale, reason. That's all on you. But in terms of your end production, it's not going to meet you where your happiness needs to go. No. You'll find out you're more miserable.
Yes. And there comes the happiness thing.
Oh,
speaking
happiness.
Of free will, next statement, listen to this.
Yeah, please hit me.
It requires living by objective principles, including moral integrity and respect for the rights of others.
Why do people hate this lady? They hate her. They legitimately hate her. She is talking about human rights at the most universal level. That is a high moral stance, to respect an individual regardless of race, color, or creed for who they are.
Objective principles. I like those.
What's objective? Right. If I peel the skin off of you, regardless of the color, you got muscles underneath, right?
Right.
You got bones, nerves, lymph nodes, all that stuff. It's all under there.
Science has proven that. That's reality.
Yeah, that's there. You can go to a Body Works exhibit. Yeah. When you walk in there, do you wonder, oh, that was a black person or that was a white person?
No.
Is that a blonde horse or is that a brown horse?
It's a human or it's an animal.
That's just what it is. That's just what it is. You should be fascinated at the fact of all the interconnectedness of everything in your body that actually makes you do what you do.
And so she says this is based off of moral integrity and the respect for the rights of others.
Why to be the best person, you have to have a high moral integrity.
Right.
Don't go out and kill. Don't do things that harm others. Don't do things that take away from their needs. That elevates you.
Mm-hmm.
But you can't even get there until you understand reality, because if you're delusional, smoking a cigarette and then saying, I'm a good surgeon, I can take care of people's health, you're in a delusion. You're in a false reality, because you're killing yourself.
Yes.
But you're saying, I can save others. That doesn't add up. The rationale, the reason's completely gone. There's nothing. And if you want to be objective about it, get rid of that guy.
Well, they also say that she's extremely negative. And listen to the statement.
It's not negative. I've gotten harped on this before. Because I can be critical, not in a bad sense, but I can just be like, that's just illogical. Mm-hmm. There's no rationale behind that.
Right.
That you're not being objective about this. And people are like, you're so negative. No, I'm not. I'm not. You're killing yourself. You know, if you're like obese, you're obese.
Yeah.
That's you. You did that.
The only way you're going to change is take 100% responsibility for yourself.
If your lungs don't
feel good. The reality is. Yeah,
because you're smoking cigarettes. That's
you. The reality is you're obese.
Yeah. That's the reality.
Right.
Wake up to it. Do not deny that fact.
Right. I was 40 pounds heavier than I am. Well, I don't even like to go pounds because I gained it all back, but I'm a lot thinner. But I was obese by standards. Scientific standards.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't until I took responsibility and said, how am I going to change this, Jason?
Yeah.
And, you know, I was mean to myself. I was like, you're a fat fuck.
Yeah.
You know, but that motivated me to say, hey, you know, I need to be around for me being productive and providing value.
Yeah.
And the only way I'm going to do that is by being strict on my diet, being the best version of myself, being strict on my diet and exercising. That's what we're doing, and getting out of nature. It's that simple.
You know what's bullshit? You walk into a Target. And you see models that are plus size models. It's not plus size. It's obesity.
Mm-hmm.
And don't put a model on there that's plus size to make other people feel okay about being obese and buying things.
Because you're changing reality.
Because you're distorting reality. That is actually unhealthy. Yes. And you're saying it's okay to be unhealthy.
Right.
It's okay to be in an obese state. You can look beautiful and obese. No, you can't. There's nothing beautiful about a detriment to your health.
No.
I don't care about the physical looks. Of course, people have beautiful faces.
Well, it's like you know, you have Samoans. Let's use them for example.
Yeah.
Like Samoan, they're just big bone. I mean, they could weigh 300 pounds and be healthy.
They're just big, beautiful,
So you look
people.
At them and people may say, well, they're obese. No, they're just, you know, I mean, there's some that are obese, of course, you know, but you can look at somebody in different cultures and different areas and they can be super healthy. And the look, like you said, the look could be totally different. But when you have an obese model,
yeah,
whatever, male, female, whatever.
It's a model. It's all for image.
It's all for image, and it's turning around and okaying. Like Rihanna did, and I this was cool. I'm down with this.
Tell me.
Rihanna did where she had models that were, this was like the first models that ever did this, and they were androgynous. So she had the whole thing was androgynous. That's cool.
That's a completely different story.
That's it. But people lump this stuff together, and that changes reality.
That's a respect for human rights.
Yes.
Yeah. That's a respect for those people being who they are genetically.
Right.
Or even with their gender that they choose.
Yeah.
But if you talk about like just people being overweight in the objective sense, you're not healthy.
No.
Being androgynous is not a function of being in ill health. Not by one mean. But if you're saying like, oh, it's okay to be in this distortion of reality, that's totally skewed.
People that are obese, and I'm talking from myself here, people that are obese that don't take 100% responsibility to be healthy will die early, regardless how we promote them
in
society. It's a law.
Don't be
it's reality.
Don't be
it's
soft.
Not going to
stop making plus size model stuff. Do not be soft and say it's okay to look like this. Do not coddle people. Don't make them feel like they're a victim of their fatness.
Yeah, or distorting reality, you airbrushing everything.
Yeah, airbrushing everything. That's just
why
as messed up.
Why can't we have them?
And just about people that are super fat, you have people that are just way, way, way too thin.
Yeah.
I see it all the time.
They're smoking cigarettes and doing cocaine to stay thin. You know, that was the whole model thing.
It's so distorted to one side. It lacks balance. But this objective, rational look at things that she's talking about has that balance. And you must strike that balance.
Well, it's so negative. And this is what she says. Listen to this. Objectivism is optimistic. Holding that the universe is open to human achievement and happiness, and that each person has within him the ability to live a rich, fulfilling, independent life.
That's incredible.
She's bringing in the universe.
Yeah, she took the macrocosm.
The universe is for us.
Yeah, she took the macrocosm and injected it into you.
Yeah. And that's truth.
Of course it's truth. It's amazing.
And that we have the ability. Each human that's on this globe has the ability to live a rich, fulfilling, independent life.
Is the universe here? Yes. Is this planet here? Yes. Are people here? Yes. Is there land we can live on? Yes. Can we feed ourselves? Yes. Do we need to be killing ourselves? No. Do we need to have riots? No. Do we have to have political travesties? No. But we're doing all those things. We're not respecting all these things that are here for us to learn. Instead, we skew a distorted reality and then live within that distorted reality and say it's okay. And then create those as a new benchmark. You're creating a benchmark of something that is not truthful. It's not objective. It doesn't actually help your evolution. It will never accrue to your happiness.
So they ask her this question, what is philosophy? Mm-hmm. This is a tough question. Listen to this. In order to live, man must act. In order to act, he must make choices.
Right.
In order to make choices, he must define a code of values. In order to define a code of values, he must know what he is and where he is. He must know his own nature, including his means of knowledge and the nature. Hold on. I got to go to the next page.
Means of knowledge and his nature.
Wait, Jason.
You good? You got me all amped up in the middle of this quote.
And the nature of the universe in which he acts. Okay, so let's stop right there. She needs metaphysics, epistemology, ethics, which means philosophy. Mm-hmm. But let's go back. In order to live, man must act. In order to act, he must make choices. Let's stop right there.
Okay. It's law of free will. You have to make a choice. And before you do it, you have to think about it. Before that action, you have to think. And that thinking requires an understanding of this world and this universe. Before you make any choice, you have to be like, okay, I see what I have. I see what I can do within my own power. Now I need to make a choice. Do I want to go do it or do I not? Do I want to skew it? Or do I want to keep it as it is?
Do I want to be truthful or do I want to lie?
That's precisely correct. Do I want to lie to others or do I want to lie to myself?
Do I want to distort reality?
Yeah.
Or live in reality?
And in living in reality, do I want to help elevate others or take away from them? See, you know, these are the choices. But if you think it through to the entire end, everything, life to death, every creational law, all the physics, you would say, you know what? Deductively, it leaves me at the point that I should only be beneficial to others. Mm-hmm. I should only be here for the point of evolution. I should only do what I can to help and be the best possible person. Because if I look at the chain of cause and effects, if I really think it through, acting like this is not beneficial. Thinking like this is not beneficial. That will create bad moral codes for me that I don't want to live by.
Right.
You have to think it through. You have to take what's in front of you objectively and say, I can use this and this and this, and what will that effect be? That will work.
Well, she even defines it more. She says, in order to make choices, he must define a code of values. And she used this word great, define.
Well, you have to define
it. She must define a code of values.
You must define it. Nobody can define it for you. So what is it?
That's a responsibility to dig deep with inside of yourself.
Yeah, that's why you have to know yourself. That's why it's a prerequisite with this. So once you know you, then you know what you need to value. And then through that valuing, you can have that as an extension of self and treat others with that much mutual respect.
Yeah, and she said, in order to define a code of values, He must know what he is and where he is. And yeah. I love this part, where he is.
Yeah, well, what are
most
you?
Most people don't know where they're at.
No, what are you?
Yeah.
And when people think where, they're like, oh, I'm in the United States. No, that's not what it means.
No.
Where are you in the evolution of your thoughts? Mm-hmm. Where are you in the evolution of self? What are you in the evolution of self? Are you a human being? Or are you just some sort of parasite on this globe?
No one asks these questions, though.
No.
Like, what are you and where are you?
You want to, do you know how much this goes against the church?
Oh, yeah.
The church.
I can think for myself.
You
want
to know what I'm saying? Because it's saying, what are you? That's for you to choose. Not for the church to say, oh, you know, you're born of sin. You got to do this. And, you know, right. You got to get on your knees. I got to get on my knees?
Yeah.
Are you kidding? No, I'm going to stand tall all day long. Right? But that's when you have that own definition of self, not having someone define it for you.
But we've seen through history, people are more than happy to find the code of values.
Well,
people
think about the code of values. I'm going to go back to obesity.
Yeah.
Who's defining the code of value? It's okay to look like this.
Right.
No, it's not. It's not okay to be unhealthy. It's not good for you. It shortens your life. And if you shorten your lifespan, that means it lessens the choices and chances for you to do great things for yourself and others. Do you really want to limit that because you have no control over how you eat? Are you serious? Think about it. You are limiting the evolution of self and others because you won't take care of yourself.
Mm.
That doctor smoking the cigarettes, that surgeon, is limiting how many more surgeries he can do because he feels like he has to pull on that cigarette.
But when we talked about fascism earlier, but when you look at, let's look at Stalin. When you look at communism,
God, you're dragging me into fascism.
Well, she talks heavily against communism. But when you look at communism, it boils down to you have to give up your free will to a group of elite that have the answers for you. And this is religion or any ism. You have to, at some point in any of these isms, you have to give yourself up for the greater cause of that ism. And that's what she's standing against. And that's why I think so many people have ruined her name.
Well, that's because these isms tell you to sacrifice yourself mm-hmm. for something that's unreal.
Yeah, that's not reality.
Kudos to her for realizing that. Yeah. And how many people have given up their lives for these isms? Capitalism, fascism, socialism, communism, Maoism, Taoism, Buddhism.
They all had a man, or we could say a man or a woman, but they all had a human that controlled you.
Every time.
It leads to that every time.
Every single time.
Unless you can take individual responsibility and it's decentralized.
Yeah.
Or free market, like she talks about, and we'll get into that later. Because
free markets only work when you have 100% responsibility for yourself. Yes.
Because she says, he must know his own nature, including his means of knowledge. So I looked that up, means of knowledge, because I was like, oh, what does this mean? He must know his own nature, including his means of knowledge. So knowledge in and of itself is different than wisdom.
Yeah, of course it is. Wisdom, listen, thank you.
You see where I'm rolling into?
Knowledge, and we will get into this in part two. Knowledge is something you get from observation, watching, okay, learning. Wisdom is something that happens when you have experience and you apply it to knowledge.
Mm.
Then I can take my knowledge and put it into action. And if I do that, if they are both rationally working with one another in balance, now I am wise. But just because I've read all the books in the world and observed all day long, if I don't have the experience to match with it, to actually test it, I have no wisdom. Zero. And we're going to expand upon this in part two.